In the winter of 1943, German engineers, the world's undisputed masters of complex machinery, captured their first intact Sherman tank. They expected to find a clumsy, mass-produced machine full of shortcuts. But what they discovered inside was a secret to reliability so simple, yet so profound, it would shatter their national pride and force them to question everything they thought they knew about building a war machine. It's a scene you can almost picture. Mid-February, 1943, deep in the dust and heat of Tunisia, a lone American M4A1 Sherman tank, captured during the chaos at Sidi Bouzid, sits under the harsh desert sun. The hastily painted German cross barely hides the American star underneath. Gathered around it aren't soldiers celebrating a trophy, but engineers, men from Germany's elite heavy panzer battalion, 501, notebooks in hand, their faces a mixture of curiosity and professional arrogance. This wasn't just a prize of war. This vehicle, still operational, was a ghost from a world they didn't understand. Because, as they would soon find out, the war wouldn't be won by the biggest gun or the thickest armor alone. It would be won by something the Germans, in their pursuit of perfection, had tragically overlooked. The simple, stubborn refusal to break down. The tank had a name painted on its hull, War Daddy II. It was from the 1st Armored Division, built not in a specialized armaments factory, but by the Lima Locomotive Works in Ohio, a place that used to build trains. To the German observers, this was the first clue that something was different about the Americans. Their orders were clear: get this tank back to Germany for testing. So a German crew climbed in and began a grueling 350-kilometer journey across North Africa to the port of Sfax. For 4.5 days, they drove it through sand, over rocky terrain, and under conditions that would have sent a German Panther or Tiger to the maintenance depot. But a funny thing happened. Nothing. The engine didn't overheat. The transmission didn't complain. The tank just worked. German crews, who were used to stopping for constant adjustments and repairs, watched with a growing sense of unease. This enemy machine, built by locomotive makers, was performing with a reliability they could only dream of. If you enjoy these deep dives into the untold stories of wartime engineering, you're in the right place. We've got a lot more to uncover today, because this journey was just the beginning of a revelation that would shake the German high command. At the port, War Daddy VII was loaded onto a cargo ship. The Army Weapons Office in Berlin was waiting. They had heard the staggering numbers of American production, but numbers on a page are just ink. This tank was three-dimensional, steel and grease-proof, that America wasn't just building more tanks. They were building them differently. As the ship cut through the Mediterranean, engineers at the Kummersdorf Proving Ground prepared a series of tests designed to break this American machine. But what they would break instead was their own confidence in German superiority. When War Daddy II rolled off the train in Brandenburg, it looked almost plain next to the sleek, menacing lines of the new Panther tank. The German engineers, meticulous and precise, immediately set to work. They stenciled armor thickness measurements on its hull, photographed every bolt and weld, and documented what they saw as shockingly simple construction. To them, it looked crude, almost rushed. But then they opened the transmission. Inside, they didn't find the straight-cut gears their own tanks used. Gears that demanded incredible precision to manufacture and constant care to operate. Instead, they found herringbone gears. Think of it like a zipper with angled teeth. It was a design that spread stress evenly, making it incredibly durable and, more importantly, easy to mass produce without the need for a watchmaker's precision. German engineers knew about these gears, of course, but they had dismissed them as too difficult to make on a mass scale. Yet here they were, in a tank built by the thousands, by a nation they had underestimated. It was the first of many humbling discoveries. The real tests began on the proving grounds. They put the Sherman through its paces on obstacle courses designed to simulate the worst battlefield conditions. They measured everything: fuel consumption, engine temperatures, power loss. After each brutal trial, they would pull the tank into the workshop, disassemble components, and inspect them for wear. They were looking for the weak points, the fatal flaw they knew had to be there. But they couldn't find one. The Sherman performed adequately in every test. It wasn't the fastest. Its gun wasn't the most powerful. But in the one area where their own magnificent machines consistently failed, the Sherman excelled. It just kept going, hour after hour, without needing a mechanic to save it. The Germans had built a thoroughbred racehorse. The Americans had built a mule, and they were beginning to realize that war is a mule's work. Then came the day that embarrassed an entire design philosophy in front of the man in charge of all German armaments, Albert Speer. It was early June 1943 at the Hillersleben artillery range. A major conference was underway. Speer was there, alongside industrial leaders and senior army officers. The agenda for the day included a simple but revealing test, a hill climb. It was a showcase of their best. A brand new Panther tank was there, its powerful Maybach engine humming. So was the Ferdinand tank destroyer, a 65-ton monster with a sophisticated electric transmission, the pinnacle of German engineering. And parked right alongside them was the captured American Sherman, War Daddy II. The Sherman went first. It climbed the slope smoothly, its simple 5-speed manual transmission shifting without a fuss. The driver, a German soldier, handled it with an ease that was almost unheard of in their own heavy tanks. The crowd watched, silently impressed. Then came the Panther. With its 700 horsepower engine, it was far more powerful. It made it up the hill. But the driver was working hard, and you could hear the strain in the machine. It did the job, but it wasn't graceful. And then it was the Ferdinand's turn, the pride of German heavy armor. It started up the incline and stalled. Right there, in front of Albert Speer and dozens of high-ranking officers, the technological marvel ground to a halt. As recovery crews scrambled to get it moving again, the message was clear and humiliating. The simple American tank had done with ease what their most advanced machine couldn't do at all. Speer himself would later write about the Sherman's surprising mobility, noting that it could climb mountains his own experts considered impossible for tanks. But the real shock wasn't about climbing hills. It was about a fundamental difference in how two nations saw the very nature of a machine. The Germans designed for the perfect soldier, a highly trained specialist who could handle a complex, temperamental machine. The Americans designed for the average guy, a farm boy from Iowa or a factory worker from Detroit who knew how to drive a truck. The Sherman's synchronized transmission didn't require the complicated double clutching that German tankers had to master. It was built with the understanding that in a real war, you don't always have experts. You have ordinary men, and those men need tools that won't fail them when it matters most. Back at Kummersdorf, the engineers kept digging, and the evidence kept piling up. They ran endurance trials, pushing the Sherman for over 2,000 kilometers before it needed any major maintenance. That was nearly four times what an early model Panther could manage. The final drives, the gears that turned the tracks, were another shock. The Panther's final drives were a notorious weak point, often failing in less than 150 kilometers. It was so bad that Panthers had to be transported by train for any long-distance move because a simple road march could cripple them. The Sherman's final drives, using those same durable herringbone gears, almost never failed. Decades after the war, museum restorers would open up the final drives of Shermans that had sat rusting in fields for years and find them still in near-perfect working order. They were overbuilt. To a German engineer, this was wasteful. Why use more steel and more complex gearing than was absolutely necessary? But to an American automotive engineer, that waste was called a margin of safety. It was the reason the machine could be pushed to its limits and beyond, and still bring its crew home. It makes you think about the cars or trucks you might have worked on back in the day. That old Ford or Chevy that just refused to quit. If this reminds you of a particular engine or a piece of machinery that was just built to last, I'd be interested to read about it in the comments below, because that's really the heart of this story. The Sherman wasn't born in a sterile lab by scientists chasing perfection. It was born from the American automotive industry, a culture that had spent decades learning how to build millions of reliable, affordable cars for ordinary people. Before the war, owning a car was a part of everyday American life. In Germany, it was a luxury for the rich. That difference in experience, in culture, translated directly into their tanks. Americans built tanks that any decent mechanic could fix with a set of common tools. They used interchangeable parts from different factories. A transmission from Ford could be swapped right into a tank built by Chrysler. This was standard practice in Detroit, but it was almost a fantasy in German tank production, where parts from one factory often wouldn't quite fit a tank from another. As more captured Shermans arrived for testing, tanks from the British and Italy, from the Soviets on the Eastern Front, the data became undeniable. They tested the M4A2 with its twin diesel engines and found it had incredible fuel efficiency. They tested the M4A3 with its Ford V8 engine, which became the favorite of American crews for its power and sheer dependability. Every single variant, no matter the engine or the factory, shared that same core DNA, automotive excellence. German field reports from their own units painted a grimly different picture. Panther crews were given a long list of things they couldn't do. Don't shift gears too often. You'll break the transmission. Avoid third gear entirely if you can. Never turn while reversing. Don't make sharp pivot turns unless the ground is perfectly even. It was like trying to fight a war with a machine made of glass. By late 1943, the German reports from the front lines were becoming desperate. Some Panther units were reporting operational readiness rates below 40%. During the Battle of Kursk, one of the largest tank battles in history, more Panthers were lost to mechanical failure than to enemy fire. Think about that. Their own engineering was a more effective enemy than the entire Red Army. They celebrated in March 1944 when they finally got the Panther's engine to last for 1,000 kilometers. This was presented as a major success. But the Sherman's diesel engine had a lifespan of over 3,000 kilometers. The Germans were celebrating a success that was still only one-third as good as the American standard. The situation only got worse as Allied bombers began to systematically dismantle Germany's industrial capacity. A raid in April 1944 on the Maybach engine plant and the adjacent ZF gearbox factory was so devastating, it halted all production of Panther and Tiger engines and transmissions for several months. When production finally restarted, quality had plummeted. They were using slave labor, and those workers, understandably, engaged in sabotage. A cigarette filter jammed in an oil line, a misplaced gasket. Meanwhile, in factories across America, workers were building Shermans around the clock, safe from bombing, motivated, and well paid. By the end of the war, they had built nearly 50,000 of them, more than all German tank models combined. It wasn't that German engineers were bad at their jobs. They were brilliant. They just had the wrong priorities. They were obsessed with creating the perfect weapon on paper, a tank with the best gun, the thickest armor, the most impressive specifications. They built Titans. But they forgot that a Titan with a broken ankle is useless. American engineers weren't trying to build the perfect tank. They were trying to build a good enough tank, thousands of them, that would always show up to the fight. And that philosophy, born from the assembly lines of Detroit, made all the difference. Even German units who captured Shermans in the field put them straight into service, often without any modifications. They were desperate for reliable vehicles. Reports from panzer regiments noted how Sherman crews could focus on the battle, while their own crews were constantly consumed with a different battle, the one against their own machine. They were always wondering, will we make it to the front line? Will we be able to get back? In the final desperate months of the war, the evidence became overwhelming. During the Battle of the Bulge, German forces captured and pressed numerous Shermans into service, valuing their reliability even for demanding operations in harsh winter conditions with limited support. The final official admission of failure came in January 1944. A report from the Panzer Commission revealed a catastrophic number of final drive failures across their entire tank fleet. Hundreds of Panthers, Tigers, and Panzer IVs were sitting dead in depots. A high-ranking general put it in stark terms. In such circumstances, orderly utilization of tanks was simply impossible. The troops lost confidence in their vehicles. When the end came and Soviet forces closed in on Berlin, the Kummersdorf proving ground itself became a battlefield. Some of the captured test Shermans were pressed into service, fighting alongside the very German tanks they had been tested against. In those final chaotic days, the Shermans kept running until they were destroyed by enemy fire or ran out of fuel. Many of the Panthers and Tigers simply broke down one last time. The story of War Daddy II is the story of two competing philosophies. One was a quest for technological perfection, a belief that a superior weapon could overcome any odds. The other was a pragmatic understanding that in a long, grinding war, reliability is the ultimate weapon. It's the weapon that ensures you're always in the fight. After the war, when West Germany began to rebuild its army, they designed a new tank, the Leopard 1. And what did they prioritize? Reliability, maintainability, ease of use. They studied the principles that made the Sherman so effective and built them into their new design. The Leopard 1 became one of the most successful and widely used tanks of the Cold War. The lesson had been learned, paid for in blood and steel on the battlefields of Europe and North Africa. The German engineers at Kummersdorf had seen the truth back in 1943. They saw it in the herringbone gears, in the simple but effective engine, and in the sheer stubbornness of a tank that refused to die. They saw that America had built a war machine that perfectly mirrored its national character. Practical, resilient, and produced on a scale the world had never seen. They knew, long before the end, that they weren't just fighting an army. They were fighting an entire industrial philosophy. And it was a fight they could never win. Stories like this are what keep history alive. If you'd like us to keep digging them up, subscribing is the best way to support the channel. It truly helps us keep these stories from being forgotten. Thank you for your time.